Sunday in the season of Lent. We are now 3 Sundays into Lent and we have 4 weeks to go. If you are a baptism candidate preparing for your baptism on Easter Day, or if you are a Christian like most of us, preparing to renew your baptism vows on Easter Day, then you will find yourself 1/7 of the way, about 20 days into your fast. And you're right in the middle of the fast, so it will be getting difficult now. But you can see the end of the tunnel. Easter is on the horizon now. The light is in the distance. Let us turn to the next slide and let us please stand. The Lord be with you. Sing our opening hymn this morning, God forgave my sin. The theme of our readings is holiness and repentance. Holiness and repentance.
God forgive my sin in Jesus' name. I'll be born again in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, I come to you to share His love as you told me to. He's in
Stephen, I'm very happy that you can worship with us.
another with the Lenten greeting. While we're greeting each other, I'd like to say welcome back to Matt Putka, who's officially back with us. He says he's not going to do tambourine classes and things yet. He's just doing mixing and readings, helping with the service before he gets still busy catching up. But he's finished his thesis, so congratulations, Matt, finishing your thesis. So we have to call you Master Matt now, is that right? Let us bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
His mercy endures forever.
Let us pray the colic for pure hearts as we say together with 80 million Anglicans around the world, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, and we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Let's praise the Lord as we sing songs of repentance and holiness this morning.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
When I gaze into your loving eyes, when I
To worship.
Lord, we acknowledge you to be the Lord. We acknowledge our sinfulness before you and your holiness before us. We acknowledge that you are other and beyond and above and over us, higher than we can imagine. You are exalted so far above the earth as the heavens are over the earth. We cannot aspire to your standard of goodness, of holiness, of glory. We love you, God. We love you, Jesus. We adore you. You alone are worthy of all our praise, of all our effort, of all our service, of all that we have and all that we are. We acknowledge you to be the Lord. And this morning we confess our idolatry before you. We confess that we have sought other gods. We confess our rebellion and our complaining before you. And we confess also our immorality, the many sins that we have committed, and our lack of moral value. God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt and out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything above, in the heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I am the Lord your God. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do your work, but the Sabbath, seven is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and the earth, and the sea, but on the seventh he rested. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or your neighbor's house, or your neighbor's servant, or your neighbor's ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. I'm going to play a little introduction to the readings. The theme of the readings is repentance. I'm also doing something a little bit different here with this. During the time of singing, I haven't plugged it in here because I think that my voice ruins the effect of the worship. So you can hear it from the congregation, but I'll put it here for the readings.
So if you're new to church, I apologize, this is a heavy message, but when you hear the sermon, you'll get the context.
I'll explain that a little bit in a minute. May we have our first reading this morning, which is read to us by Matthew Podger. Thank you, Matt.
Good morning. The Old Testament reading comes from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 to 15. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." And then he said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." He said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians, and to bring them out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppressed them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" He said, "I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain." But Moses said to God, "If I come to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am." He said further, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'I am has sent me to you.'" God also said to Moses, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'The Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my title for all generations.'" This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Matt. Welcome back again. Let us turn to the psalm on page 2. I invite you to join with me as we say it from side to side by whole verses. I'm going to say the whole thing, so I'm going to join in with both sides as we did last week, so it will be recorded for the Facebook recording. So let us begin on this side. O God, you are my God. Eagerly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a barren and dry land where there is no water. Therefore I have gazed upon you in your holy place, that I might behold your power and your glory. For your loving kindness is better than life itself. My lips shall give you praise. So will I bless you as long as I live, and lift up my hands in your name. My soul is content, as with marrow and fatness. My mouth praises you with joyful lips. When I remember you upon my bed, and meditate on you in the night watches. For you have been my helper, and under the shadow of your wings I will rejoice. My soul clings to you, your right hand holds me fast. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. The epistle reading is read to us by Marlene Bayan. Thank you, Marlene.
Epistle reading from the 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1 to 13. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses, in the cloud and in the sea, and all they ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock and followed them. And the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them, and they were struck down in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as example for us, so that we might not desire evil they did. Do not become idolaters, as some of them did. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality, as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and were destroyed by these serpents. And do not complain, as some of them did, and they were destroyed by the destroyer. These things happened to them to serve as an example, and they were written down to instruct us on whom the ends of the age have come. So if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond her strength. But with this testing, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Marlene. I'd like to just teach you a very simple little chorus. And it goes like this. We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now, for we are standing in his presence on holy ground. Now, last year, when we had our Easter Saturday youth service here in the hall, we lit the Easter fire, what's called the new fire. We actually had a pile of salt soaked in alcohol, and we lit it. And Crystal walked around the group of youth. The youth were standing around the fire. It's called lighting the new Easter flame. The idea is that at the beginning of Holy Week, people would put out the fires in their homes. And then they would have no fire during Holy Week. No warmth, no fire to cook with. They would eat cold leftovers during Holy Week. And then on Easter Saturday night, they would light the new fire in the church and everybody would take the fire home. And on that night, we lit the fire and Crystal walked around the youth group, unknown to me, just in the dark, taking photos of the group singing and worshiping. And as she walked around, there were pictures of angelic figures over the youth, and it was very striking. Now, it might have been somehow the fume from the fire going up, but they sure looked a heck like angels to me. And there was one over Ayrton, there was one floating overhead above Ayrton and some other youth, and there was one over Matt and Bia, and there was a very wispy, faint little one near me. So I don't know what you make of that. Maybe it's just somehow a trick of the light. But it was very touching. I have the pictures on my phone. I can bring them and show them to you. I've shown them before. I can show them again. But actually, also in Iraq, during the war against ISIS there, when the church was being persecuted, as Christians were gathering in secret to worship, they had many experiences of seeing angels during the worship. And they took photos, and the photos are apparently in the book by Vicar of Baghdad, Reverend Andrew White, in one of his books about glory under fire. And so it's a lovely idea that the angels are with us as we worship. There's also a story from America a few years ago that we showed in youth group recently. What's that called, Matt? Heaven is for real, thank you. By the story of Scott Burpo, in which the little boy has a death experience or near death, and he sees angels worshiping in church with the church members. So I believe that the angels are with us and they're worshiping with us. So I want to invite you to sing this with me. Jesse, do you know this melody? Do you know? I know you're so gifted you can just play by ear. You don't have to, no pressure, but if you do, feel free to join in. We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let's stand up. Let us praise Jesus now, for we are standing in his presence on holy ground. We are standing on holy ground, and we know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now, for we are standing in his presence on holy ground. Next slide. Lord, give us peace when there is war, love when we don't understand, and hope at the end of a bitter day. Lord, help us sit down with mug of tea and share our hopes and our dreams, oh Lord. Oh Lord, step into our shoes today in the things we do and say. I can see no other way. Oh Lord, oh Lord, step into our shoes today. Verse 1, sing it for the Ukraine. Lord, give us peace when there is war, love when we don't understand, and hope at the end of a bitter day. Lord, help us sit down with a mug of tea and share our hopes and our dreams, oh Lord. Oh Lord, step into our shoes today in the things we do and say. I can see no other way. Oh Lord, oh Lord, step into our shoes today. Please remain standing for the gospel reading.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke, chapter 13, beginning at verse 1. Glory to you, Lord Christ. At that very time, there was some present who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. He asked them, that is, Jesus asked them, do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will all perish as they did. Or what about verse 18, who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them? Do you think they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did. And then he told them this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and still I find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil?" The gardener replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year, until I dig around it and put manure on it, and if it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." This is the gospel of the Lord. Lord, give us peace when there is war, love when we don't understand, and more. Happy end of a bitter day. Lord, help us sit down with mug of tea and share our hopes and our dreams, oh Lord. Oh Lord, step into our shoes today in the things we do and say. I can see no other way. Oh Lord, oh Lord, step into our shoes today. Please be seated. Two weeks ago, somebody left this white purse here in the hall during church. If you can tell me what's on the back of it, it's yours. It's got a small amount of money in it. Better still, if you can tell me what's inside. But if you can tell me what's on the back, you can have it. Does it belong to anybody? Anybody lost their purse? No? Oh, well, the church made $40. Okay. 2 weeks I've announced it now, so. All right. Anybody want to guess what's on the back of it? No, it's Bruin and Bunny. Coney. Bruin and Coney, those spiffy characters. What are they? You know. Anyway, nobody guessed. That means it's mine. It's really good. All right. I apologize that the bulletin is sparse today. It's because our copier was giving off ominous warnings that the toner tank needed emptying. And when it does that, it can stop, it can die at any moment. So we made the bulletin just very basic today because we didn't know if we would make it through the bulletin run. Fortunately, we did. So I sent you out a text message if you have on the WhatsApp list. But let me just mention again the notices for the events coming up this week. On Wednesday night, the ladies group facilitators will meet with me at 6 p.m. here to overlook Acts chapter 10. And then at 7 p.m. after that on Wednesday night is our church prayer meeting. We would love to welcome a few men. If there's any men would like to join, we usually have about 12 women and me, or 11 women and me. So I'd love to have another guy there come and join us for our prayer. You're most welcome. We pray for an hour for the church, and it's always a wonderful time of intercession for the congregation and for the world and for the school. On Friday night, our young adults are having a social night at the Puffin Cafe. We're having a vegetarian or vegan night, I guess, at Puffin Cafe on Friday night at 7:30. On Saturday night, the International Ladies Bible Study will be meeting at Jolene's home. If you'd like to join, you can ask who Jolene is and we can introduce you to her. You're most welcome. On Sunday morning, Team Jesus will be practicing at 10 a.m. for the Easter dance. And at 9:30 on Sunday morning, the Sunday school teachers will be in room 4A for Sunday school teachers meeting at 9:30 next Sunday. That's the monthly preparation. Also next Sunday is the English Mother's Day. The Commonwealth and English countries celebrate Mother's Day on the fourth Sunday in Lent. It's called Mothering Sunday. And the tradition is to go back to your home church. It's also traditional to bring your mother a cake called simnel cake, which is something sweet in the middle of Lent and fasting. So mum gets a special cake during Lent. And also you're supposed to bring your mother
purple posies are preferably made of, Miss Anna, what are those purple flowers? Violets. It's hard to get violets these days. So next Sunday, we're going to have a cake, a seminal cake, for all the mums at morning tea for English Mothering Sunday. And we're also going to have purple roses for the ladies. We're trying to source them. So Mothering Sunday, you know, bring along any mums you know who you'd like to invite for next Sunday. Also, the week after next is our men's group. Men, please start to sign up. You guys requested a social. We always have Bible study, but this time we're going to have a social. So you asked for it, please sign up and come along on the 31st. And last but not least, we are signing up for Ellis's benefit dance. Now, last week, you guys, people didn't understand the request. We have sign-up sheets at the welcome table, and people thought that it was a sign-up to bring food. That's a secondary reason. The primary reason to sign up is we want to know who's coming. We want to know numbers, and we want to ask everybody to sign up if they can come, please. Please come and help support. It's going to be dance, country and western. We're going to be doing line dancing. The Filipinas are going to teach us some line dancing. We're going to have a lot of fun. There'll be bales of hay, dress up, cowboy hat, check shirt, jeans, whatever, you know, look like cowboys and cowgirls. And so the theme is country and western benefit dance for Ellis. Ellis is an American after all, you know that, right? So we're going to be doing that, and during that time we will have an offering. We're going to sing Ellis's favorite song, The Sound of the Saints, and we're going to take up an offering. So there's no admission charge, but early on in the program we'll have an offering, and please come generously. I said I would tell you how much I would give, but my wife told me that that's wicked and I shouldn't do that. So I wanted to inspire you, but she said, no, we're not supposed to say what we're giving, and she's quite correct, of course. So I'm not going to say what I'm giving, but we're asking people to be generous so that we can make a generous donation. We can't be doing this all the time, so we want to hit it hard and give a really good gift to the family to show our love. They've never asked us in the last 2 years for any money or anything, and now they're asking for Ellis's future. The dear boy is getting bigger and bigger and stronger, so it looks like he's going strong. So with all your love and tender care, who massage him every week, he's growing and going strong. And also, Crystal and I had a bit of a shocking experience. I know this is misleading and confusing, but every time I see him, I ask him to move a finger or blink an eye. And he never moves. You know, there's no movement. There's no response. And this week I said, Ellis, if you can understand me, can you point a finger? And he had his hands on his chest like this, and he went like that. Just instantly, bang, like that. And Crystal and I went, whoa! You know, that was the reaction. We both went, oh! Well, because he went, bang! And then we both said, whoa, you can understand us. So it was very striking. And then 5 minutes later, I asked him again, can you do that again? Nothing. Didn't move. So he might have been upset, or maybe he didn't understand. I remember Ian said to me last year, he thinks there's a connection which sometimes connects and sometimes doesn't. But it was really dramatic, because it wasn't, like, normally his movements are slow, but his index finger went bang, just like that, second I asked him. So I don't know what to make of that, but it made me feel like I'm going to just keep praying for him. And I don't want to mislead you, and I don't want to create false hopes, but I just feel like as long as he's with us, we need to keep praying for him. And keep praying that God will do something. Yep. Okay, so I'm not going to have 30-second testimonies today, maybe next week. Is anybody disappointed? Anybody wanted to give a 30-second testimony? No? All right, maybe next week, okay? Let's do that. Let's stand, and we'll join hands and sing our dismissal song, May God's Blessing Surround You Each Day. Thank you, guys.
God and King, you are the same.
bless you guys.
Each day.
Hello, darling. Please be seated and let us pray. Lord, we ask that you would help us to be encouraged this morning through the word, through the message that you have for us, that it will be a challenge for us to be sincere in our faith and not to come to the baptism renewal of Easter with hypocrisy in our hearts, but to come sincerely worshiping you without idolatry, without rebellion or complaining, and without immorality. Help us to come and celebrate a sincere and unhypocritical Easter celebration of the resurrection this year, we pray. Give us genuine and true repentance. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. This morning's messages are quite challenging because they contain basically warnings. There's some comfort, there's some grace in the messages, but I'm warning you now, gird your heart. Prepare for it, okay? Because warnings and challenges are coming in today's reading. As I've been reading the readings over the last few weeks, I'm reminded of something that I've really only been learning in my 50s and 60s. In the past, I always thought, and I know that many in our church think, that church is something, it's an option that you can do. You can go to church occasionally. You can go sailing one week. You can go to church another week. You can go and have lunch another week. You can go and play with the kids in the park another week. And church is just something you do. And I want to challenge that mentality this morning for this reason. You wouldn't send your children to school and say to them, oh, just go to school today, but tomorrow you can go to the park and play, and then the next day you can go swimming, and the next day you can go sailing, and the next day you can sleep in, and maybe next month we'll go back to school. Would that be good? And all the children said, yes, you know, that'd be good. But actually, that's how we treat church. We just say, oh, well, you know, I'll just come for a while and this time because I feel like doing church today, so I'll get my church fix. And I'll feel good and I'll feel holy and I'll feel close to the Lord again. And then, you know, but maybe next week I'll do something else and the week after something else. So in any church, now I'm not picking on anybody this morning. I said I warned you. Today's message and readings is going to kick you in the butt. But it's not my intention to kick you in the butt. The readings are kicking you in the butt, okay? So don't blame me, okay? I'm the messenger boy. I'm delivering to you as best I can what the messages in the scriptures say today, and they are a kick in the butt, okay? So one of the things that I've realized out of these readings is that we tend to treat church this way. And actually, church is a curriculum, particularly the readings, the lectionary readings. It's a curriculum. And if you miss one part, first of all, you get a warped understanding of who God is. For example, can anybody remember what our reading was about 2 weeks ago, the first Sunday of Lent? What was the gospel about 2 weeks ago? Now, this is hard putting you on the spot. If you put me on the spot, I probably wouldn't remember because my brain is pretty foggy these days. But I'm going to give you a moment to recollect. Were you here 2 weeks ago? You were here last week. Huh? Not love at all, not even close. Love is a good general answer. You could say Jesus. The answer is always Jesus, right? But that wouldn't be quite right. Yes, Mark. Thank you, sir. A little child will lead them. Just give him a clap. Yeah. It's about, what is Lent? It's 40 days of fasting, preparing for the baptismal celebration at Easter. And the beginning of Lent, the first Sunday in Lent, the baptism candidates would hear, and us, we are also going to renew our baptism vows. That's part of Easter celebration. On Good Friday or on Holy Saturday, we renew our baptism vows. So we hear of the 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness when Jesus was tempted, when he confronted Satan at the beginning of his ministry. You remember now, right? If you were here 2 weeks ago, it's coming back to you. Now, that is a really important plank in understanding living part of the life of Jesus. You can't miss out the temptation of Christ. It tells you a lot of things about Jesus, as you would know if you were here 2 weeks ago. For example, it tells you that the first temptation of Jesus was to take the easy way, to wave his magic divine wand, turn the stones into bread. But if he did that when he came to the cross, he could just wave his magic wand and call the angels to bring him down, and he wouldn't have to face the cross. He could just wave his magic wand and say everybody is forgiven, but we know that wouldn't work, because somebody had to pay the price for sin. There had to be the perfect offering for sin so that the judgment could be satisfied. There has to be justice as well as love and mercy. And so Jesus had to go to the cross in his humanity. And so if he, at the beginning of his ministry, had taken the easy way out, then we would never have been saved. If Jesus had turned those stones into bread, he would have started on a path of taking the easy way out, of greed and self-centeredness, that would not have ended in the cross, and we would not have been saved. So this tells you something incredibly important about Jesus. It tells you about his humanity and his divinity, and how he had to keep them in balance, and how he had to go through the suffering of this life in his humanity. And Luke tells us, at the end of 40 days, he was what, Mark? Starving. He was famished. Good man. But he was hungry. Now, why does Luke say that? I said, thank you very much, Captain Obvious. You're hungry after 40 days of starving. Because Luke wants us to know he wasn't doing those 40 days and 40 nights in his divinity. He wasn't like drawing on divine power. He was doing it in his humanity. It would be just as hard for him as it would be for you if you're healthy. Don't do it if you're not healthy. We had two people in our church in Hong Kong who did 40-day fasts. So impressive. But if you have health issues, they say you shouldn't do it, and you should only do it with the supervision of a doctor. But I know two people who've done that. And so I know it's possible, and it didn't kill them. They were fine, actually. And they felt very good for it, and, you know, yeah, it was good. So it's doable, but it's hard. So these readings tell us about Jesus, and they tell us about God, and they tell us about the enemy. The story of the temptation tells us that there is an enemy, and it's a personal enemy. It's not a nebulous, impersonal force of evil in the world. There is a Satan. There is an accuser, an enemy, who desires the destruction of your soul. Let that sink in for a moment. There is a demonic being roaming around this world who wants you destroyed. That's very chilling. It gives pause for thought. It tells us that we need to take this seriously. So you see, that's just 1 week. Now, if you missed that week, you missed really important lessons about the Christian life. Now, as we're preparing for our baptism, some of you may remember, if you've done my baptism class, what are the two criteria for being baptized? For example, if you want to join Cathay Pacific, you have to have a bachelor's degree, you have to speak an Asian language, and you have to be a certain height. Why do you have to be a certain height? To reach the luggage. Exactly. Very practical. If you want to join the Christian church, you don't need to be a certain height, you don't need a bachelor's degree, you don't need to speak an Asian language, and you don't need to know the rules of football. What do you need to do? There are two criteria for baptism. Anybody? Tell me one. Sorry? Ah, repentance is one. We must repent. What's the other one? We must believe. I tell the children, it's believe and behave. Or have faith and repentance. These are the two criteria. You don't have to have a PhD in biblical studies. You don't have to attend 6 months of theological college courses. You have to do two things. You have to have faith in the Trinity and faith in the risen Christ, that Christ is risen. And number two, you need to repent and be sorry for your sin and willing to try to follow Christ and live his way. It's really simple. Not easy, but it's really simple. Now, last week, anybody remember who was here, what was the Old Testament about? Who was the main figure? There was a picture or a cartoon of him up on the screen. Does that bring back a memory? Sorry? I can't hear you. Oh, no, not Harlequin. That was the week before. We had Harlequin the week before on 40 days and 40 nights. Yeah, he's not a biblical character, by the way. Sorry? Abraham. Thank you, Doreen. Abraham. Anybody remember now? Do you remember that last week we had the reading of the cutting of the covenant? God makes the covenant with Abraham, and there's a sacrifice of blood, And the covenant is a contract. You remember that? It involves promises, where God makes promises to us, and Abraham responds in a certain way to God. The four promises that God made to Abraham was the... Anybody want to help me? What's one? Yes, that Mark. Okay, so he will have a descendant, that's to start with, because he's an old man and his wife is postmenopausal. They're both about 90. So the first promise is he'll have an heir, and his heir or son will be his own issue from his own body. And included in that his descendants will be as numerous as the stars in the sky or the sand on the seashore. Well done, I'm proud of you, mate. What's another promise? Have you ever heard of the promised land? Thank you very much. Second promise was land. God promised Abraham that his descendants would have a land because they were landless. They were wandering desert dwellers, Arameans from Iraq, from the central Iraq today, from the city of Ur, the Chaldeans. They were not Arabs, they were not Jews, although Abraham is the ancestor of the Jews and the Arabs, we believe, we say. So certainly of the Jewish nation. So, promise, first of all, descendants. Secondly, a land for the descendants to live in. Anybody remember the other two? A name. He was promised a great name. He was a nobody wandering in the desert with his sheep, and God promised him that the whole world would know his name. You know, that's something that human beings covet. We want fame, and he wanted a name. But it doesn't just mean fame. It means a good name. It means an honored name. Well, who is honored more than Abraham? He's honored by the Jews, by the Arabs, by the Christians. He's honored by everybody. He's the father of what? Faith. He's the father of faith. Why is he the father of faith? Let's come back to that in a second. What's the fourth promise? So we have descendants, land, a name. The fourth one is the most important. You must know this one. This is the whole reason why the rest of the Bible is written. Sorry? Blessing. He was promised that through his descendants, one of his descendants, the whole world would be blessed. And that came about through the coming of Jesus into the world. So the story of the Bible from beginning to end is the story of God's fulfillment of these four promises to Abraham. That's what the Bible's all about. Now, the Bible is a library of books. It's 66 books written over 1,500 years by more than 40 different authors, and yet it has a unity. And the unity is, it's all about the fulfilling of these four promises, especially the fourth one. And since it's about the fulfilling of the fourth promise, the promise of the whole world being blessed, the focus is upon the one who would bring the blessing. And the Jews had a special name for this one. They called him the Messiah, good man, or in Greek, the Christ, the anointed one, the one on whom God's presence and power would dwell in complete fullness. Emmanuel, God with us, mighty God, Isaiah calls him, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Daniel tells us that he will establish a kingdom in the time of the coming Roman Empire, which will be a kingdom that will fill the whole earth and that will never end. And all these promises have come true in Jesus. So last week, we began the Old Testament with who again? Abram, right? Does anybody remember the epistle last week? I'm really stretching you now. It has something to do with faith. I'll give you a clue. It talks about, you remember this gesture? Nobody? Anyone here last week? Stand your ground. Stand your ground, good boy. Was he the only one awake last week? Stand firm. I love this boy. Stand your ground. He's not here with the youth. He's out here with the adults because he's hungry to learn the word of God. Bless your heart, brother. Don't be proud. Be humble. Be humble. Be humble. It's a gift from God. Whatever we have, intelligence, anything, it's a gift from God. Memory. Yeah, we talked about stand your ground, and it's referring to your faith. Stand firm in your faith. But what is our faith in? No, more specific than God, as Christians. Who do we believe in? Jesus. And what's the key to Jesus' identity? What is it that tells us that Jesus is really God? There's a clue there. He died and he rose again, the resurrection. The heart of the faith is the resurrection. Paul says, if Christ is not risen, then our faith is meaningless and we are lost in our sins. The heart of our faith is we believe in the resurrected Christ, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. This is the heart of the faith. So last week we heard about Father Abraham, the father of faith, and how it says that Abraham believed God. That means he believed the four promises. And God counted it to him as righteousness. He wasn't a righteous man. He wasn't a particularly good man. But God chose him and he believed God. He was a man of faith. When God said, leave Ur and walk to the west, to the land I'm going to give you, he had to walk 1,000 miles to get to Canaan, the land of Canaan. Long, long, long way away. And he just got up and he went. That takes tremendous faith, you know. So he's a man of faith. He put his, you know, the rubber hit the road with Abraham. So last week, so remember, going back now to the conditions for baptism. What are the conditions for baptism again? Number one, faith. Faith first, okay? Number one, faith. So we've talked last week, 2 weeks ago, we talked about the temptation, right? This is the curriculum. This is the baptism curriculum. First week, 40 days and 40 nights of temptation. Jesus' temptations, his temptations to idolatry, temptation to take the easy way out, to greed, and temptation to pride and insecurity, to show off how great he was. Jesus' temptations, his confrontation with the devil. That was week one. What was week two? Faith. Abraham, the father of faith. So it began with Abraham. And when you read those readings, you thought, what the heck does Abraham have to do with the resurrection? And the answer is faith. He's the father of faith. We have to have faith in the resurrection. The heart of our faith is the resurrection. So you look at the readings, you see, oh, now I understand why they chose these readings. And in the epistle, he's telling us, stand firm in your faith. And the gospel last week, my memory's failing me now, the gospel is Luke, where the Pharisees come and tell Jesus to get away because Herod is trying to kill him. He says to them, you will not see me until the time when you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. So he turns his face to the cross. It foreshadows the resurrection. So the point about the gospel last week is it points to the resurrection. Both the epistle and the gospel point us to the resurrection. Jesus is now turning in Lent. He's turning his face to the cross and to the resurrection. So those are the readings last week. So the theme last week is faith. So the question is, how's your faith? If you want to follow Christ, if you want to have eternal life, we must have faith in his Son. We must have faith in God who came in humanity into the world to die on the cross and to rise again, to conquer sin and death. This is the heart of our faith. This is the first condition of being a Christian, the first condition of baptism. And for us who are already Christian, it's the first condition of renewing our baptism vows on Good Friday or Easter Saturday. We must have faith in the risen Lord. This is a challenge if you're considering baptism. Do you have faith in Christ? That he came, he died, and he rose. This is our faith. But today, the readings are weird also. You look at the readings, and it's like Moses, Corinthians, and then the gospel is weird. All these Galileans and Pilate mingling their blood. What the heck is that all about? Well, if Abraham is the father of faith, who is the father of righteousness in the Old Testament? Who is the giver of the law? Who is it who teaches us that God is holy? Moses. Moses is the great lawgiver. So Abraham is the father of faith. Moses is the lawgiver. It's Moses who encounters God in what? The burning what? The burning bush. And what is the first thing God says to Moses? Hi, Moses. Nice to meet you. No. What does God say to Moses? He addresses his apparel. It's like meeting the school principal. Take off your shoes. Why? Because the land on which you're standing is what? Holy ground. We are standing on holy ground. Ooh, my goodness. He's standing on holy ground. Why? Because out of the bush, is the burning bush that's not consumed, is speaking a holy God. Now, there are two kinds of holiness. There's the holiness of God and the holiness of people. The holiness of God means that God is apart from us. He is above us, beyond us, better than us. He is perfect good, perfect love. He is perfect righteousness. He is, but more than anything, he is apart from us, above us, and beyond us. That's the holiness of God. Our holiness is different. Our holiness means we are set apart for God. So it's got to do with being apart, but it's a different kind of apart. It means you take your life and you say, I will give my life to God. I will set my life apart for his service. I will not worship other idols. I will not pursue sexual immorality. I will not commit adultery. I will not steal. I will not lie. I will not bear false witness. I will not covet things that don't belong to me. I will do what is right in the eyes of God. I will not be immoral. And I will not be a whinger and a complainer to God. I will not be a rebel. I will serve and trust the Lord. You see, this is what it means for us to be holy. It means for us to repent of our sins of idolatry, rebellion, complaining, immorality, and set our part alive, a life apart for his service. So his holiness and our holiness, they both have to do with being apart, but it's a different kind of apart. He is apart above and beyond. But we set ourselves apart so that we can approach a little unto his holiness. You understand? We set ourselves toward his holiness as best we can a little bit. So Moses is the one who discovers that God is holy. So with Abraham last week, we learn about God. The week before, with Jesus, we learned that there's a devil. We learned that Jesus is tempted. We learned that about the incarnation, that God is human and divine. We learned that Jesus needs to overcome the enemy before he begins his ministry. We learned that it's the Holy Spirit who drives Jesus to face the enemy, because God the Spirit knows that Jesus needs to defeat the enemy before he can go doing miracles and healing the sick and all that good stuff that he's going to be doing. He needs to first conquer his humanity. He needs to first be victorious over his humanity, his temptation, because if he's not, then he can't make it to the cross. He can't be our Savior, and we are lost in our sin. So we learn about so much about God. And then last week, we learned from Abraham. What did we learn? You help me. I want to walk away from the mic, but this terrible thing is tying me here. Sorry, guys, in Facebook land. You're my ball and chain. What did we learn about God from the story of Abraham? God is what? I'm going to have a rest, let you think for a moment. What is the Abraham story? The cutting of the covenant. What does it tell us about God? See, it's all about God, right? As our Christian faith. We're here to learn who is God. So we had a big lesson last week about who is God. What do we learn about the nature of God? From Abraham. Anyone?
God is faithful.
Yes, God is faithful. Okay, that's a great point to start with. God makes promises and God keeps his promises. What else? Think simply. What are you taking for granted? Yep. Okay, he's powerful. He can make things happen. So he's God. He's powerful. Okay.
Sovereign.
But what is... Sorry?
Sovereign.
Sovereign. Yeah, but what about his character vis-a-vis us? Yes, thank you. God is the initiator. God is the one who approaches us. God is the one who initiates relationship with us. And secondly, he's the covenant-making God. This is what I was looking for. He's the one who wants a relationship. A covenant is a marriage. It's a relationship. Marriage is a covenant. He wants to be in relationship with you. He wants to covenant with you. He wants to make promises to you and you to make promises to him. And he will be your God and you will be his son or daughter. He wants that. You see, Allah does not want that. One of the greatest sins of Allah, of Islam, is to attribute to Allah the sin of shirk. Shirk is association. Allah doesn't associate. Allah doesn't make covenant. Allah doesn't enter into partnership. The Quran says Allah does not enter into partnership with any human being. So actually, the concept of Allah and the concept of Jehovah are diametric opposites. Because Jehovah God is a God who longs to enter into covenant. He longs to enter into relationship. He is the God of love. He is in a Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, within which there is community, there is love, and he wants to draw you into that community. Is that amazing or what? But Allah is one, is one and all alone, and evermore shall be so. Allah does not enter into covenant. He does not. And so when you associate to Allah partners, that's like the worst blasphemy in Islam. It's called the sin of shirk. So if you say, well, you know, God enters into partnership, you know, your Muslim friend will not be pleased at all. And that's why they dislike Christianity so much. Because the whole fundamental theological basis of Christianity is that we believe that it's revealed by Abraham that God is a covenant-making God, that he enters into covenant with us. So you see, if you missed last week, then you missed that. You missed that God is a covenant-making God and that it's all about relationship, and that Christianity is not a religion, which means something religio is to bind up, religare, the Latin to bind. Religion is not something that binds us up, but true religion is a relationship. It's a relationship, and that's what we learned from Abraham last week. And our religion of relationship believes in a resurrected Savior who came to conquer sin and death. If you weren't here last week, you didn't learn that God loves us so much that he wants to be in relationship. If you weren't here last week, then you didn't learn that the heart of the matter is the resurrection, and the heart of our faith is the resurrection, and that we are called, Mark, to stekete. You remember that? What does it mean? Stand firm. Stand firm in what? Stand firm against comics? Stand firm against not being vegan? Stand firm for what? Stand firm for what? It's not rhetorical. What faith? Faith in what? What about Christ? The resurrection. The resurrection. Turn to your neighbor and say, the resurrection. It's all about the resurrection. We stand firm in the faith. Christ has died. Christ is? Christ is what? Christ is what? Risen. Christ will come again. It's the heart of the matter. That was last week. So today we have Moses. What do we learn from Moses about God? What kind of God is this? Holy. He's holy. How does he feel about sin? Not too pleased. Not too pleased about sin. Marlene read that terrible passage so gently and beautifully, she almost made it sound lovely. But it's not lovely, Marlene. It's not lovely. That Corinthians. In that Corinthians passage that Marlene read, Paul uses the Moses story as a metaphor of the Christian life. And he says, you baptism candidates who are preparing for baptism, or you Christians who are already baptized, you are baptized into Christ, into membership with God in Christ. And you have partaken of the spiritual food, the communion, the bread and wine, just as the Israelites partook of the water from the rock in the desert and the manna from heaven in the desert. But he says, those Israelites, they thought they were safe. They thought everything was copacetic. God is our God. Abraham is our father. We trust God. Actually, they didn't trust God. They were always not trusting God. But they said, you know, we have Abraham as our father. We have drunk from the rock. We have eaten the manna. We are safe. We are circumcised. We are God's people. Check the fine print. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with them, and they were struck down in the wilderness. You see, this is a moment. This is a moment. This is like a warning moment. This is like, are you feeling pleased with yourself? You're baptized, you're maybe a pastor or a priest, or you're a Sunday school teacher, or you've been a Christian for a while, and you're like, well, I'm pretty pleased with myself. I'm baptized, or I'm going to be baptized. I'm a good person. And it says, God was not pleased with them. And then he gives examples from the wilderness. He says, now these things happen to teach us as examples, so that we might not desire evil as they did. And then he mentions idolatry. It says they sat down to eat and drink and they rose up to play. That means they made the bronze cow. They worshipped the idol of the calf in the desert. And they rose up to play means they rose up to play sex games, to worship their fertility calf. It was a fertility god. So they made their idol and they worshipped it in sex games. That's how they played. That's how they did worship back in those days. The people sat down to eat and drink. They rose up to play. It's a metaphor. And then he says, we must not indulge in sexual immorality. The word there is porneia. Porneia. It's where we get the word porn from. It means anything other than sex within marriage, between a husband and a wife. any kind of sex. So when I lust with my heart or with my eyes, if I look at porn, or I lust after a woman or someone else's wife, then I've committed porneia, sexual immorality. So it's any kind of sexual sin, basically. It covers all kinds of sexual sin. Now, all of us have committed idolatry. Most of us have things that we sometimes put above God, whether it be our soccer game on Sunday morning, or whether it be our laziness or money or family or whatever it is, we put things before God. These are idols. And many of us have committed some kind of immorality. We've stolen or we've lusted or we've done things that were wrong in our life. And then the third sin is the sin of complaining. That's rebellion. The Israelites, the Hebrews, were always complaining against God, rebelling against God, blaming God. That's fundamentally unbelief. It's a kind of sin of faith. And all of these are summed up as putting Christ to the test. How were the Hebrews putting Christ to the test? They never heard of Christ. They were in the wilderness. But because they were believing in the future salvation of God, they were indirectly believing in Christ. And so when they committed idolatry, Paul is saying, when they committed a rebellion and complaining and immorality, they were sinning against Christ. But you see, his point is not to address the ancient Hebrews. Who's he addressing? He's addressing the people reading his letter. And he's saying, you guys are like them. It's a metaphor. You Christians in Corinth who are preparing for baptism, you feel like you are, or who are baptized, preparing for renewal of baptism, you feel like you're righteous because you're baptized and confirmed and you're even going to church. But he's saying, are you committing idolatry in your heart? Are you putting money or sex or power before God? Are you committing immorality? Are you faithful to your husband or wife? Are you looking at porn? Are you immoral or cheating or lying in some way? And lastly, are you in rebellion against God? Have you submitted your heart and your life to God? Or are you still sitting in rebellion? You say, Lord, I don't really want to submit to God. You see, he's challenging our hypocrisy. This is not addressed to non-Christians. This is not a season to bring non-Christians to church. Do that on Easter Sunday. This is a season for Christians to get a kick in the butt. This is talking to Christians, right? Saying, you guys preparing for baptism, have you repented of your sin? You say, I'm baptized into Christ. I partake of communion. I eat the spiritual food and the spiritual drink. But am I sincerely following Jesus in my heart? Do I sincerely put Christ first in my life? Do I sincerely keep the commandments? And I have to stand before you and say, no, I'm not. I'm a hypocrite. I fail in many of these points. I worry too much about money and will we have enough when we retire and what kind of home will we have? I worry too little about giving to the needy around me. That's an idol. I worry too much about myself and my health and things like that. That's an idol. I have sexual immorality in my heart. I have rebellion in my heart. I'm like, oh God, I don't want to do what you want me to do all the time. That's rebellion and complaining in my heart. So I am number one that he's talking to. And he's saying, Stephen, just because you're a pastor, just because you're baptized, just because you're confirmed, don't think that that's going to save you. You understand, this is a severe warning. So if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall. Would you turn to your neighbor and say, watch out? Be gentle. And then we come to the gospel in conclusion. And there's this weird story, two stories about the Galileans whose blood Pilate mingled with their sacrifices. Well, we think we know what that was about. So Pilate was a Roman governor, and Roman governors were always building aqueducts. You know what aqueduct is? It's the tower that brings the water from the country to the city. And Pilate, being a good administrator, had this genius idea. His genius idea was that he would take money from the Jewish treasury, from the temple, and he would use it to build the aqueduct. And he was very pleased with himself. It's like, oh, that's a good idea. I'll use the temple money to build the aqueduct. Everybody will be happy with that. What do you think? Were they happy? No, why not? Whose money was it? It's God's money. It's temple money. It's priest money, but it's God's money. So Pilate stole the money from God, and he used it to build his aqueduct to glorify Rome. And they were really upset. And so people went into the temple to protest against the building of the aqueduct. Now, Pilate wasn't a total idiot. He knew, it was a bit of an idiot, but not a total idiot. He knew that he couldn't send in soldiers with swords to break up the riot and the protest. So he sent in Roman soldiers with clubs, with cudgels hidden under their tunics. And they went in and they mingled incognito, in mufti, as the Romans used to say, in disguise. They mingled with the crowd. And then at the command of the centurion, they pulled out their clubs and started beating the tar out of all of the Jewish protesters who were protesting against Pilate. Except they were Roman soldiers and they were idiots and they weren't well paid, so they got carried away. And they cracked a few skulls and there was blood in the temple. So you can imagine the temple, there was the sacrifice of the bulls and the lambs, but also mingled with the sacrifice was the blood of the Galileans. Galileans were always hotheads, always ready for a protest or a riot. And so we think maybe this is what the story is referring to. And so Jesus asks the question, were those Galileans who got their skulls cracked by Pilate's thugs in the temple? By the way, Pilate's men should not have been in the temple at all. The inner sanctuary of the temple where the sacrifices took place was only for Jewish men. So the Roman soldiers shouldn't have been in there. So that was extremely offensive to Israel. And of course, the violence that was done was unspeakable for them. So it was a terrible thing. So it was a total mess up by Pilate. A total, publicity nightmare. Anyway, long story short, people were asking Jesus, those guys that were killed, were they worse sinners? And what does Jesus say? Does he just say no? He says no emphatically. He says, no, I tell you, no. Emphatically no. What does that tell you? Well, in Israel, there's this very close, in the Israelite religion, there was this very close connection between personal sin and judgment. And so when they saw a man who was born blind, they asked Jesus the question, whose sin caused him to be blind? His sin or his parents? And Jesus said, neither. This has been done for the glory of God. And Jesus always rejected this argument, but you find it in Job. In Job, one of Job's comforters, Eliphaz, bear in mind, Job's comforters are not speaking for God, they're speaking against God. It's in the Bible, but it's not God speaking, right? Eliphaz says, anyone who suffers is guilty. They're not innocent. If you suffer, you're not innocent. So this was very strong in the Jewish understanding. If you suffered, it was because you sinned or your parents sinned. Now, Jesus repeatedly and emphatically rejects that theology. So anyone who says, you sin, you know, you have this plague because you've sinned. You know, you hear this on the news sometimes, there's an earthquake, and the fundamentalist preachers will come on the news in America and say, those people in Iraq have sinned and God has struck them with an earthquake. That's really bad theology. Jesus rejected that kind of idea, that individual judgment was put on people in this life because of their individual sin. It is true that there is judgment on nations. And that's another subject, and that's quite an interesting subject, that when a nation sins corporately, God does bring judgment. And so maybe the earthquake thing can fit in there. It also should give Mr. Putin pause for thought at this time, because Russia is going to suffer because of his sin. And the people of Russia, who are innocent, many of them, will suffer because of his sin, because they are implicated in his sin. So there is judgment in the scripture on nations. But Jesus says that individually, that's not the case. And here he's very emphatic. Anyway, the story about the Galileans and the tower is not important. What's important is the warning. Jesus says, no, they're not suffering because of their individual sin. But I tell you, if you don't repent, you will all die like them. More. You know, Jesus doesn't mince words. And then he talks about the tower. Maybe these guys were workers building the aqueduct and the tower of the aqueduct fell on them. So these guys were already sinners because they were taking money that belonged to God from the Romans. So they were sellouts to the Romans, maybe, if you extend the story. We don't really know what was going on with the tower. But the tower fell on some Jerusalemites. And Jesus says, do you think they were worse offenders than all the others in Jerusalem? Again, he's emphatic. No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you'll all perish, just as they did. So basically he's saying, stop asking stupid questions and look to yourself. Look to your own sin. Because if we don't repent, then our baptism and our communion won't save us. You know, basically what this is saying is you can't be a hypocrite. This whole message today is an attack on hypocrisy. It's saying you can't fool God. It's referred to as putting Christ to the test. So when we come for communion or baptism, and we say, Lord, look, I'm holy, I'm coming for communion, I'm coming for baptism, but in secret, where our lives are full of adultery, lust, immorality, rebellion against God, then what God is saying here through Jesus is it doesn't cut the mustard. It's not good enough. And what that comes back to is God is holy. God is holy. And God requires his people to be holy. I told you today is a kick-butt sermon, I'm sorry. It's not from me, it's from the message. Last week it was all nice and warm and fuzzy. God loves us. God makes covenants. Stand firm in your faith when you're under attack. God will be with you and strengthen you. This week it's a kick in the butt. God is saying, cut out the hypocrisy. It's not going to help you. If you don't come in sincerity, then there's no salvation for sin. That's what Jesus is saying. It's saying, wake up to yourself, church. Wake up to yourself, people. Stop being hypocrites. And then it concludes with the fig tree. A man, let's say the man is God, had a fig tree in his vineyard. So it's a grape vineyard, but he's got a fig tree. That was common in the old days. They practiced mixed culture, mixed agriculture. So there's fig trees and others planted in the vineyard. And he comes and there's no fruit. And he says to the gardener, which presumably is Jesus, see, for 3 years I've come looking for fruit. There's no fruit. Cut it down. It's wasting soil. And the gardener, maybe I like to think it's Jesus, I don't know, says, maybe it's just a parable. Maybe I'm reading too much into it. But the gardener says, sir, leave it alone for one more year until I dig around it and put manure on it. I think that's pretty funny. If you're not being fruitful in your life, guess what's going to happen? God's going to dig around you and dump a pile of manure on you so that you can be a bit more fruitful, okay? It's funny, isn't it? You know? And the gardener is going to pay attention to you. He's going to prune you. He's going to dump some manure on you. And he's going to see if you can be fruitful in your Christian life. And if it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, cut it down. No messing around. Today's message is dark, stark. It's a warning. It's a warning to baptism candidates not to be hypocrites. It's a warning to us Christians as we approach Easter to come with sincere hearts and not to come as hypocrites. And I think, oh God, have mercy on me. And you think, how can any of us be saved? How can we be saved? Well, to find some comfort, we look back to the epistle. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. We all face these temptations. There's none of us here holy. There's none of us here perfect. Not one. But God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, he will provide the way out, so that you can endure. So there's the words of grace. There's the comfort. If you're sincere and you do your best, the Lord will strengthen you and help you to find your way out of temptation. It won't be easy necessarily, but that's the comforting part this morning. So I hope that you've understood what I've been talking about. There have been several messages woven together. You can see from these three sets of readings, this is a curriculum. This is a baptism preparation curriculum. It's what it's for. And the psalm today is for baptism candidates to encourage them. You have a look at it and read it again. It's to encourage you as you're preparing for your baptism. So what are the two criteria for baptism? Faith, as represented by Abraham, the father of faith. And secondly, repentance, as represented by Moses, the father of the law and of righteousness, who introduces to us to the holy God, who is other than we are. And we are called this morning not only to staccato, not only stand firm, but to stand in repentance, lest we perish. Let's take a moment of silent reflection. Lord, we ask that you would strengthen us as we seek to sincerely come to Easter with true repentance. Help us not to be a church of hypocrites. Help me not to be the number one hypocrite. Lord, help us to sincerely repent so that when we drink of the cup and eat of the bread, we do not drink judgment to ourselves. We do not test Christ's mercy. Help us to be sincere, Lord. Save us from hypocrisy. Let's take a minute of silent reflection. God hates sin. Make no mistake. Do you think he's crying about my sermon? Maybe he just realized he's a sinner. Let's stand, shall we? Sorry. Let's profess our faith in the words of the Creed. We declare together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation,
he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit, who was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. May we give the Sunday school 5 minutes call, please. Please be seated, friends. We haven't done this for a while. I'd like to just give you an opportunity to have twos or threes. We don't have time for fives or sixes, but could we just form pairs or threes and just pray for one another for strength to finish Lent? If you don't want to pray, you don't have to. Don't feel threatened or uncomfortable. It's quite okay just to say, hi, good morning, how are you doing? Okay, so can we, if you feel comfortable, let's move into pairs or threes. No fives or sixes. And let's just pray for one another that we can finish our fast, or pray for any need that you have. Just pray. Please, no fives or sixes, guys, just pairs or threes. Just say a prayer for one another quickly. Thank you. Four is okay. Four is okay. No more than four. Just say good morning, how are you? How can I pray for you? Everybody needs a prayer sometimes.
us draw our prayers to a conclusion if you have another minute. Please pray for me to preach shorter sermons so we can have more times like that to share and pray. We need that time, don't we, to share and pray. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, says St. John, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God is faithful and just, and will forgive our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbour in the words of this corporate confession as we pray together, Most merciful Father God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive what we have been, amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Hear these words of absolution. May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sin through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. May we please stand. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us greet one another with the shalom, the peace and the love of Christ. Peace be with you. Thank you.
Let us sing our offering hymn, All That I Am, All That I Have. And welcome back. Is Donnie here? Oh, Donnie didn't come. Oh, is he here? He's hiding in the back. Oh, welcome back, Donnie. All right, wonderful. All That I Am. Let's sing our offering hymn, friends. Who by his death on the cross on Good Friday and rising to new life on Sunday has offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with the whole company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Now, Father, we pray that we who receive these, your gifts of bread and wine, according to our Savior's word, may be partakers of his body and his blood. For on the night he was betrayed, he took bread,
And when he had given thanks to you, his almighty Father, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup of wine, and again, giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. We declare together, Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Sanctify these gifts by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son. We offer our prayer and praise, Father, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ our Lord. Blessing and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen. And as our Savior Christ taught his disciples, we are confident to pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness,
but in your manifold and great mercies.
We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same, Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God, his body broken and his blood shed. Just as the Hebrews drank from the rock and ate from the manna from heaven, so we too drink from our rock, which is Christ, and we eat of the manna, which is the bread of life, the body of Christ. Let us take them in remembrance that Christ died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. We do extend this invitation to you. If you believe in Jesus and are baptized in his name, you are welcome to take communion this morning. This is not an Anglican table so much as it is Christ's table, and you are welcome to receive with us today. If you're not baptized or you're not a believer yet and you'd like a blessing, can you just cross your arms? Please teach your children to cross their arms if they're not baptized or they're not ready to receive communion. Thank you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. quality of Lord bless you and keep the child.
Spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood,
Send us into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessing. Unto God's gracious mercy and protection I commit you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those whom you love, now and forevermore.
Amen.
Amen. I'd like to welcome, we have a visiting reverend today, Reverend Jimmy, from a Chinese ministry with the poor and the needy, so I don't know him. I don't know him, but he's with Lani, so he must be all right. By the way, if there are children or Sunday school teachers who didn't have communion, I've reserved some communion. You can come and see me during the closing hymn now. If you haven't had communion, it's not too late. Let us sing, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. This is a song from India.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided.
Thank you for tuning in, friends.